What's cracking, big dogs? Welcome back to the HQ. It's your man's Nicholas. Happy Monday. Happy start to the week. I hope y'all are ready to have a fantastic week. If you're listening to me, you're already starting your week off the right way, because it's In the Muck Monday. Every Monday, we dive into two players that are similar in 2018 fantasy football. They're getting picked around the same spot or on the same team or both rookies or some kind of ish like that. Today, we are diving into two top 10 running backs. We got Leonard Fournette. We got Melvin Gordon. I know some of y'all were pissed that I did Devontae Parker, Jameson Crowder, but listen, bro, not everyone plays in six-man leagues where all your picks are these top players. So sometimes I gotta get in the muddy muck, man. These are the mud-made monsters that I gotta get into. But we'll go back to the top guys, because I know you guys like that. Plus, it brings in more traffic to me, so I guess I can't really complain. Leonard Fournette, Melvin Gordon. Leonard Fournette right now, pick number 12 overall, running back 9. Gordon is two spots ahead of him, 10th overall, running back 8. As always, before we jump into the video, I want to know which of the two you guys like more and why. Drop a comment down below. I'm going to give you like 5 seconds to do that. Just scroll down a little bit, drop a comment, and we good. Cool. And while you're down there, hit that thumbs up button, man. It makes me know that you guys like these videos. And of course, I'll keep making them throughout the summer leading up to your drafts. So let's get in the muck. Couple things before we jump into the analysis. I need you guys to do me a really quick favor. So a good friend of mine is starting up a YouTube channel. It's not fantasy football related. You don't really need to do anything. He wants to change his name on YouTube, and they don't let you change your name more than once unless you have 100 subscribers on your channel. So if you guys wouldn't mind, it would be a huge help to me. You'd be helping one of my friends out. I would really appreciate it. Plus, you just gotta follow him, and then once he hits 100, you can unsubscribe from him. I don't really care, to be honest with you. I'm gonna link him down below. All you gotta do is scroll down, hit right click on your mouse, or hold your thumb down on the button if you're on mobile. Go open a new tab so it won't take you out of this tab, out of my video. Open a new tab, go over to that, hit subscribe to his channel real quick, and then exit out. And that's all you gotta do. He just needs to hit 100 subscribers, so I'd appreciate it if you guys just did that real quickly. Do whatever you want with that afterwards. If you are looking to sign up for the newsletter, you just head over to bigdogsfantasy.com, scroll down to the bottom of the homepage where you can put your info in, and every week I'll be sending you out a sleeper, a bust, and a tip or trick fantasy football related. Last week's, I believe, was showing you how to get the Pro Football Focus Edge Package plus a $10 entry into DraftKings for the entire total price of $10 for those two things. So that's kind of the stuff you'll get with the newsletter. And yeah, let's jump into it. So we're going to start off with my man's Melvin Gordon, because he is ranked a little bit higher than Leonard Fournette. And we'll just, you know, we'll make our way down the rankings. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about Gordon's past a little bit, right? He was the 15th overall pick back in the 2015 NFL draft by they were the San Diego Chargers. Rest in peace, man. I'd be so pissed if I was a player and we had to start playing in LA rather than San Diego, but that's neither here nor here, so we'll move on with the analysis. Gordon ended up having an absolutely brutal rookie season, fantasy football-wise, of course. He would touch the ball 217 times in that rookie year, and he wouldn't score a single touchdown, rushed for 3.5 yards per carry that year. Among 44 running backs that saw at least 100 carries that year, Gordon's 3.5 yards per carry ranked second to last, only in front of Matt Jones. Who? I don't even know. I'm not even going to acknowledge that statement to the god Mike Jones. He ranked 43rd out of a qualified 44 running backs per Football Outsiders DVOA for running backs. That's Melvin Gordon, which is basically just anytime you hear DVOA, anyone explaining like Football Outsiders DVOA, whether it's for a pass defense, a run defense, a running back, a quarterback, DVOA is basically Football Outsiders is measure of efficiency, regardless of what position they're at. So Gordon was horrible that rookie year, right? Especially from a statistical standpoint. But I wanted to dive in, like, was it all Gordon's fault? Like, should he have been better? Or what was the deal there, right? Really, I mean, it wasn't all his fault. Of course not. It's a team sport. There's a lot of other players on the field, a lot of other factors that go into this kind of thing, right? In the same year, that rookie year, where his statistics were pretty bad, his tackles evaded per attempt, so like just tackles avoided on each rushing carry, per PFF, ranked 6th among 38 running backs in the NFL that had 125 carries or more. So he was actually pretty good running the ball on just an efficiency standpoint and making guys miss. And those are the kind of predictive statistics you want to look at to determine whether or not a running back is good. The zero touchdowns. So here's the problem there. He had zero touchdowns, which is a huge problem, of course, but he literally received just one single carry inside the opponent's 5-yard line that year. Danny Woodhead saw 5. So Danny Woodhead saw 5 times the amount of carries, the amount of goal line carries that Melvin Gordon saw that year. He didn't see a single target inside the opponent's 10-yard line that year. And he saw two total red zone targets in the passing game. We're talking about Melvin Gordon still. Danny Woodhead saw 17 red zone targets that year and 8 10 zone targets. So 8 targets inside the 10-yard line. Their offensive line ranked 31st in run blocking per Football Outsiders in 2015. So while we could say Gordon was bad, there was plenty of blame to go around. We fast forward and we're looking at an absolute fantasy stud in Melvin Gordon over the last 2 years. He finished as RB7 in fantasy in 2016 and RB5 in 2017. Woodhead tore his ACL 2 games into Gordon's sophomore campaign, which really opened things up for Gordon in terms of volume and in terms of being a more well-rounded back and being more involved in the passing game. Became the feature back. He saw 295 carries in 2016, 295 touches, and then 341 touches in 2017. More importantly, though, for fantasy purposes, he scored 12 touchdowns now in back-to-back seasons, which is among, you know, if you're going to score 12 touchdowns consistently, you're going to be among the league leaders in the running back category, of course, or in any category, obviously not quarterback-related. He's also caught 99 passes over the last 2 years. So that was a big part of the game that when he came into the NFL, people were concerned, is Gordon a red flag in the passing game? Is he going to be a zero? Especially with Woodhead already in the mix, but him out of the mix now opened up the opportunity, which showed us that Melvin Gordon can absolutely play in the passing game, and he did so by catching 99 passes over the last 2 years, especially last year when he caught 57 balls, which was ninth among running backs last year, would have been top five in 2016. So a large number, 57 passes is huge in PPR and half PPR. The big knock on Gordon is, let me close my window real quick, I apologize. People across the street from me literally have a garage sale every week. Like, dude, no one wants to buy your fucking clothes of your children, like, I don't know, that have been wearing for 2 years. It's out of control. I might go over there and just drop a couple stacks on them and be like, never have a goddamn garage sale ever again. Who's calling me right now? Ooh, I hate when I get riled up because I'm not in the zone. I'm not in the muck anymore. Now we gotta dive back into the muck. Shimmy it down, it just do. All right, the big knock on him is his efficiency, right? He still can't get that yards per carry number up. He still has yet to hit over 4.0 yards per carry. It was 3.9 last year, it was 3.9 the year before that. But yards per carry is not a predictive statistic, guys. There are a million variables that go into that number. So when you're doing your analysis, just saying, you'll see a lot of lazy-ass fantasy analysts that will say, oh, he can't hit 4.0 yards per carry. He's at 3.9 yards per carry. He's never going to be that elite back. But guys, there's so many things that go into it. How many linemen do you have lining up? How many defenders are in the box? Is it stack box? Does your line suck? Are their linebackers awesome? Are you getting a huge portion of your carries within the 5-yard line? Like, all these things affect yards per carry. Are you the third down back that gets a lot of third and one, third and two, when all you want to do is get 1 yard? Like, all these things affect your yards per carry, and that's just not a predictive statistic when you think about it. So when we look at the other things we can break down going into 2018 to see Melvin Gordon's outlook, the first thing I look at is the offensive line. Now, over the last 2 years, they've ranked 23rd and 26th in run blocking per Football Outsiders, and 22nd last year in yards before contact per PFF. They're entering 2018 overall as PFF's 23rd ranked offensive line. However, they do have some big upside because of some of the players that they brought in this season. In 2017, the Chargers used both their second and third round picks on offensive linemen. Their second rounder, Forrest Lamp, was projected to be a starter on their line last year, going into his rookie year. However, he tore his ACL in the summer, ended up missing the entire rookie year. He's had a year to recover, but what's a red flag is he's still without a timetable to return. He's still, you know, in a day and age where torn ACLs, people come back from them pretty quickly, or a lot more quickly than most people have done in like previous years, you know, like a decade ago. The Chargers GM still doesn't have a timetable for him to return, and that's never good when you have this much time to get back and have the full season to recover from everything. So that is something to kind of monitor. So he's not cleared for training camp yet, and we're going to have to keep that monitored to see, you know, because this is an offensive line that has ranked low, but they have a high they have a high ceiling if things can break their way. Now, their third round pick last year, Dan Freeney, was thrust into a starting role after Matt Slauson was lost for the year, and he got better, and he started off really rough, but he got better and better and better as the year went on, and he should enter this year as like a key piece of that offensive line. So that's a big upgrade for them going into their second year. That should be a big jump for this offensive line. The third piece is that they signed former Dolphins center Mike Pouncey. 2 years, $15 million deal. Pouncey has been in and out of their lineup for the last couple of years, just dealing with different injuries and concussions and all this stuff that's gone wrong with him. But he's still relatively young for a lineman. He just turned 29, And if he can stay healthy, he'll be a really solid starter for this Chargers team, because we've seen throughout his career when he is healthy, when he's on the field. He, in his earlier years, he was kind of dominant, but he's fallen off a little bit because he's missed a lot of play time, of course. If he can stay healthy, that's just another piece of upside for this offensive line. So depending on how you look at the line, if you're completely optimistic, you're looking at Freeney, you're looking at Forrest Lamp, you're looking at Mike Pouncey completely upgrading this line, and that's obviously going to be huge for Melvin Gordon. But there's a good chance that like one or two of those things don't go right. Look at Gordon. His statistics steadily improved over the past few years. The main cause has been his volume, right? He's still not as efficient as we'd like to see. He was Football Outsiders 29th ranked running back per running back DVOA in each of the previous 2 years. He is a guy that ranks at the top of the list in terms of like yards created, breakaway runs, overall touches, and touchdowns per player profiler, but those are volume metrics, not efficiency metrics. You look at his breakaway run rate. He ranked 28th in the NFL last year. His juke rate, which is making guys miss through juke or just like breaking tackles, 25th in the NFL last year. Yards created per carry was 21st in the NFL last year. And fantasy points per opportunity. And his tackles evaded per attempt, so per Pro Football Focus, was actually lower in 2016 and 2017 than it was in 2015. So that kind of tells me that a lot of his success, at least for like running back statistics, came through way of volume. That being said, as long as he gets volume, he's going to be a top 10 back again, of course, fantasy purposes. You got to look at the depth behind him, right? You look at who the Chargers have in the backfield besides Gordon. They have Austin Ekeler, who came on as a rookie and really, I'm not going to say he exploded, but he semi-balled out a little bit, right? He's definitely his name is definitely on the radar, and he had some really good games last year. He finished with 539 total yards, 5 touchdowns, which is pretty good for a rookie running back. As a clear-cut backup on just 74 touches. So those are really good numbers on a small amount of touches. He caught 27 passes, and all that is despite being uninvolved within the last 2 weeks of their season because he had a broken hand. I think he actually suited up, but he didn't get like almost any playing time. So 539 total yards, 5 touchdowns, 27 receptions, despite kind of missing 2 full games. He averaged 5.5 yards per carry compared to Gordon's 3.9, but that's such a small sample size, we don't like to weigh those things heavily. Just saying he was efficient as a back. He's not a guy that I see as a serious threat to Gordon's workload. Here's why. You can get hyped up about Ekeler and his efficiency last year, but one, you don't chase efficiency in redraft. Two, he didn't really have volume ever, right? And that is what you chase in redraft. Ekeler saw more than 4 carries in just 4 games last year. So he had 4 carries, or more than 4 carries, so 5 carries or more in just 4 games last year, and 3 of those 4 games were blowout wins where they outscored the opponents a total point total of 120-50. So he had a few games where he saw a little bit of volume, and the only reason he got that volume was because they were blowout wins, is what I'm trying to get across. So there's no talent, there's no reason to believe that Ekeler really gets a high volume workload this year. He might eat into some pass catching work because he proved that he could do that with the 27 catches. However, Melvin Gordon like really, really showed that he can play on all 3 downs. And I was listening to an interview with Melvin Gordon on the Fantasy Footballers podcast. Next Wednesday, my interview with Andy from the Fantasy Footballers on this channel is dropping, man. It's the first of the series where we're breaking into the fantasy football industry. No player analysis. We're looking at the marketing, the growth, the social, the business side of fantasy football and the industry. And he's the first guest I have on. We did the interview last night. It was phenomenal. You guys are absolutely going to love it. Plus, a lot of you young guys who are trying to up and come, or for any like entrepreneurial-minded person or anyone trying to do better, we really got into like deeper talks about life and things like that. So you guys are thoroughly going to enjoy that. So next Wednesday, is that next Wednesday or this Wednesday? Oh, no, next Tuesday, whatever. But anyways, Melvin Gordon was on the Fantasy Footballers talking about how he wants to play all 3 downs. He gets pissed off when he gets taken off the field. Yeah, he gets upset when he gets taken off the field. He's just like me. When I say I'm upset every 2 words, I'm upset. But the OC, Ken Whisenhunt, said that Gordon could actually be or should actually be more involved in the passing game. It's kind of hard to buy into that considering he caught 57 balls last year, and that's a lot for a running back. But nonetheless, if he sees Gordon as improving more and more, there's no reason to take him off the field on 3rd downs or in pass-catching situations. So, you know, you have Ekeler, and they also drafted Justin Jackson. Oh, the other part of this is, too, who's getting the goal line carries? It's all Melvin Gordon. He saw the 3rd most rushes inside the 5-yard line last year with 14 of them. So he had the 3rd most goal line rushes last year. Austin Ekeler saw literally just one of those. So Gordon is in no danger of losing that kind of work. He has 15 pounds on Ekeler. And you look at the other running back, Justin Jackson. Now, a lot of people are going to get hyped on Justin Jackson as People get hyped on, and any rookie running back that comes into the league, you will find people that are on that bandwagon. The thing with Justin Jackson is there was like a million running backs picked before him, right? He was a 7th round pick, 251st overall to the Chargers. You could like him, you could like his college game, you could like what he brings to the field, but at the end of the day, he is, Melvin Gordon makes him redundant, and Justin Jackson is a 7th round pick, man. Without clear touches on the field, he will never have the opportunity to showcase what he has. And like, I know you could say Chris Carson was a 7th round pick. They had a plethora of injuries last year, and they had guys who were just horrible in front of him, and then he finally got on the field and showed what he could do. Justin Jackson won't get that opportunity unless Melvin Gordon gets hurt or something for whatever reason. Justin Jackson comes out of Northwestern, so bad competition in college. Less than 20 pounds lighter than Melvin Gordon. He's 6 foot, 193 pounds. He has some wiggle, but he's a very lean frame, and he's not really going to be able to barrel over any defenders. So I have no doubt that he's kind of going to be playing third fiddle in this backfield, and I'm not really nervous about him taking over any of the work. He was the 34th percentile weight-adjusted speed score athlete per playerprofiler.com. You look back to his college days. He's a back that's actually nifty. Like I said, he's got like a decent build, but he's pretty lean in his frame. He could do a lot of things at the position. He's a kind of a jack of all trades, but I wouldn't say he excels at any one thing. He gets taken down pretty easily by tacklers because of his lean frame, and I just think it's really a depth play here. You just look at the 7th round draft capital, and it's really easy to predict that it's probably not going to work out for Justin Jackson in that sense. So I'm more nervous about Ekeler taking pass catching work from Gordon than anything else in this backfield. But Gordon is set up to have a tremendous amount of work in this offense. His workload should be huge. The other thing I kind of wanted to mention that I thought was going to be a positive, or still can be a positive for sure, but it was the Chargers defense and how they were going to be super elite. But then, as always in Chargers fashion, injuries occurred. They already lost Jason Verrett, who hasn't played in a while, but still was going to be a key piece of this defense if he were to return healthy. I believe Trevor Williams was also taken off the field at practice. I'm not sure how deep the injury went with him, but if they lose both of those players, that's going to be big hits to this defense. They still should be really awesome with Bosa and Casey Hayward, and I can't remember the name of the rookie safety that somehow fell to them in the draft, but they should be a very good defense, set them up with good field position. So that's another good piece for Melvin Gordon. Before we get into Leonard Fournette, I have to thank today's sponsors of the video, FantasyJocks.com. Yeah, we're ghetto in here. I hold this thing up behind my boots. Tim's to your grill, baby. FantasyJocks.com, the industry leader in championship belts, rings, trophies, live draft boards for your league. I use their draft boards for my E-Town Get Down League. I'm going to be using it for my live draft in New York City, which is coming the end of August. Bro, that's going to be a sick weekend. If you are new to the channel, I'm bringing out 9 of my subscribers to New York City. We're hanging out from Friday to Sunday. We're doing a live draft on Saturday in the Airbnb, which is a dope penthouse in Hell's Kitchen. It's going to be sick, so stay tuned for that vlog. But all that stuff is going to be sponsored by Fantasy Jocks. We got the draft board, we've got a trophy, we've got all that stuff, and you can get this for your league if you use promo code TAKE10 or TACOCORP, TACOCORP, you'll get 10% off your purchase. All you got to do is chip in $5, $7, $9 per league mate, and you have yourself a trophy. You can get your league's names engraved on the actual belt or trophy, man. They got Lombardi trophies. They got all types of trophies there. It's some really, really gnarly stuff they got working on over there at Fantasy Jocks. So thank you for sponsoring today's video. And guys, go check them out. I will link them down in the description. Take 10 or Taco Corp for 10% off your order. Also, if you have not checked out my draft guide, which is updated weekly throughout the summer, it is completely interactive, completely online, on your phone, on your computer, on your laptop, on your tablet, whatever it is, head over to bigdogsfantasy.com. This will also be linked down right below. Head over to the shop section, and it should be the first product in there. It's got all my rankings, top 250 rankings by tiers. It's got my top busts, top sleepers, top must-draft players, a Bible on how to attack your draft position by position. It's like an 8,000 word article, along with a bunch of other exclusive articles, and I update it weekly and put new videos and blog posts in there that are exclusive to the draft guide. So if you have not yet purchased the draft guide, I highly suggest you go do that, because it'll help you. You don't really need to look at elsewhere besides the draft guide for this year's fantasy football draft. Whew, that's all the plugging I can do, man. We are out of electric over here. Let's move into Leonard Fournette, and I'm gonna need some more energy for this, man. Okay, so Leonard Fournette. I'll preface this by saying I am probably higher on Leonard Fournette than almost any single person, fantasy analyst, any player in the industry. Think he's my 6th or maybe 7th overall player, someone who has my rankings in my draft guide. We'll have to fact check me on that. The way I look at it is the 4 running backs that are elite, right? You have the Johnson, Zeke, Gurley, Bell. Those are the first four guys, right? I'm not debating that. But Fournette is my next ranked running back, probably tied with Barkley. I think I actually have Barkley ranked ahead of him. But the way I look at it is every single guy outside of Leonard Fournette has multiple question marks, has at least two red flags or question marks. I'll bet they might be small, but there are question marks. The singular red flag, the only thing I see wrong with Fournette's outlook in 2018 is his injury history and the injury past he has. He is the clear-cut lead back workhorse featured back in the league's fifth highest scoring offense, who ran the ball more than any other team in the NFL last year. They ran the ball 33 times a game. The next closest team was the Vikings at 31.3 rushes per game behind a much, much, much improved offensive line from 2016 to 2017. Now they bring in all-pro left guard Andrew Norwell, who was the top free agent guard on the market. He was PFF's number three overall graded guard. So they improved their line tremendously from 2016 to 2017 and now only improve it more from 2017 to 2018. They have an amazing defense, right? That obviously we know that. That's going to set them up with great field position. They will dominate time of possession and use Fournette to kill the clock and let their defense and their run game win games for them. They are a team that's trying to mask their quarterback in Blake Bortles by running the ball with Fournette. And he far overachieved in the passing game, where people had him penciled in as a virtual zero. Literally, the only thing I see wrong with Fournette is the injuries. And I'm going to break down the good and the bad as well. These injuries are a very, 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 very real concern. Dating back to his college days, he has dealt with ankle, knee, foot, quad issues. So this is definitely a real red flag. I'm not overlooking the injury history here. And I did have Dr. Jesse Morse on my show. I interviewed him last week. He is of the Fantasy Doctor, so at the Fantasy DRS. I highly recommend go following him as well as the Fantasy Doctors on Twitter. He came on the show. That episode will be dropping on Saturday, this Saturday. We talked about quarterbacks and running backs who, you know, with injury plagued running backs and quarterbacks and their outlook for 2018. So stay tuned for that one. He said that he believes, based on Leonard Fournette's like chronic ankle issues, that there is he gives it a 75% chance that Fournette misses at least one game with ankle issues in 2018. That kind of scared me because I was like, damn, I was really hoping that he wouldn't be as concerned about Fournette's red flags in terms of injury as some people are. But this is a doctor speaking. So he puts it at a 75% chance that he misses at least one game in 2018 with the ankle injury. He went in depth explaining the ankle. I mean, the man's even, he literally like took his socks off. He took his shoes off. He went on his webcam and like put his toes all in my, I was like, all right, at ease, soldier. But he got really in depth explaining what was wrong with Fournette's ankle. And he's basically telling me that like when you suffer the things that Fournette suffered in his ankle, it's not like a bone where it re-heals itself and comes back stronger. It actually gets a little bit worse or a little bit weaker each time he deals with this ankle injury, which is obviously not a good thing. However, and this is none of that was good news, of course. The big thing here, the big however here, is that reports are coming out of Jaguars camp that Fournette is coming into camp at 223 pounds. That's his lowest weight since high school. Fournette weighed 240 pounds at the NFL Combine and reportedly played last year at 235 pounds. If he is reporting in at the 222 or 223 pounds that people are saying he is, that is a 12 to 17 pound drop off from the Combine to his playing weight last year. I was asking Dr. Jesse Morse, like, do you think this is good for Fournette? Like, what's the meaning of this weight loss? And he said, absolutely, it's definitely a really good thing because this is scientifically backed up. For every pound of body weight that you drop, so 1 pound of body weight gets 4 to 5 pounds of force removed on your knee and your ankle every step you take. So every time you step, right, 4 to 5 extra pounds of force is going down on your knees and your ankles for every pound of body weight. So if he's lost 12 to 17 pounds, and this is true, and he's really slimmer, that is so much less excess force on that ankle and on those knees. So that is going to be huge. If those reports are true, then the injury concern for Fournette is much more minimal than we originally had it pegged for. So that is why I'm high on Fournette, is because if these weight reports are true, and I know we have a lot of those coming out, but this is significant, so it's definitely something to keep an eye on. The other thing is he had a lot of things working against him, even though he was super successful in the games that he did play last year. Fournette faced eight defenders in the box 49% of the time. Todd Gurley faced eight men in the box 17% of the time. That's over 32% more of his carries or over his snaps, which is crazy. Fournette faced a stacked box on the third highest percentage of his rushes in the NFL last year. The Jags had, you can look at that and be like, well, he's probably going to see exactly the same thing this year. But I would probably argue that, right? They had many breakouts from Keelan Cole, from D.D. Westbrook. They bring in Dante Moncrief. They draft D.J. Chark with their second round pick. And they bring in Austin Seferian Jenkins. So they bring in all these weapons. Now, I'm not saying they're all going to break out or all going to be actually good weapons, but that should alleviate some of the pressure that Fournette saw in his third highest percentage of stack boxes, right, last year. So I think that should help him a little bit in terms of the pressure that's going to be in the boxes for him. I want you to look at this tweet from Grant Barfield, who you guys should absolutely be following, one of my favorite guys in the industry, one of my favorite fantasy analysts. His first tweet, his original tweet, before going on injury report in week 7, I think I actually cut it off, huh? In week 7, Leonard Fournette forced at least one missed tackle on 19% of his carries, 6th best in the NFL, and had 4.6 yards per carry, 8th best in the NFL. Leonard Fournette shedding his weight to 225 pounds in an attempt to maintain his fitness and his chronic ankle problems under wraps is nothing but good news. He was very explosive and violent in weeks 1 through 6 last year before the ankle injury. So, he was good before the injury. When he's healthy, he's really, 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 really good, especially as a fantasy running back. Now, you might say that he was inefficient, and he was sluggish at times, but I'm saying that's not who he is as a running back. That was only injury-related after it happened, and he couldn't really plant and be explosive on that ankle. When he's healthy, he is an absolute beast. He combines power and he combines speed, a monster that can break away at any point, and you evidence that by he had 75-yard and a 90-yard touchdown run last year. Even if there was huge holes, right, and no one touched him for the first 10 yards, you still have to have legit breakaway speed in order, because there are elite fucking athletes behind you chasing you down the field. If you can run 90 yards without being caught by one of these defenders, you have legit breakaway speed. And Leonard Fournette proved that twice on those runs. So I think a big part of Fournette's season is going to come down to if he does have that ankle injury when it occurs. So if he does have the ankle injury, then it's possible that he loses a lot of his explosiveness after that. But if he can hold that off for a long time, or if it doesn't happen, then I expect Fournette to be easily one of the top 5 running backs in fantasy this year. We look at Fournette's production last year, right, from a number standpoint. He played in 13 regular season games and 3 playoff games. So he played in a 16-game sample size that we can use, right? So including playoffs, Fournette totaled 1,628 yards, 14 touchdowns in 16 games as a rookie. My absolute favorite part about Fournette this year, without a doubt, is his sheer workload and the volume floor that he's going to have in this offense. Last year, he ran the ball 268 times in 13 games. That was 7th most overall carries, despite missing 3 games, guys. Only Le'Veon Bell and Zeke had more carries per game than Fournette did in his rookie year. And I was looking at some of the Vegas odds. And my next Wednesday video is breaking down some of the Vegas odds, the player props in terms of like over-unders for yards and touchdowns and who's going to lead the league in passing yards, receiving yards, that kind of stuff. So I'm going to dive into those and break them down for you and tell you what that means. But right now, Fournette, it has the 4th highest odds of winning next year's rushing title behind only Zeke, Gurley, and Bell. So remember that when you are fading Leonard Fournette. I would personally put him number 2 only behind Zeke in rushing attempts and rushing yards. That's how high I am on him. So the other thing, as I'm talking about, the volume workload, the floor of Fournette's workload. He had 19 or more touches in 14 of 16 games last year, guys. 19 or more. There are not a lot of running backs that could fit that category. I didn't go back and look, but I would assume it's like maybe Gurley, maybe Bell, maybe Zeke, and Zeke only played in 10 games. So like Fournette is in that class. And if you look at the most important games, the 3 playoff games, right? Because that's when the team needs to be as good as possible and use their best play calling and their best players. Fournette's touch count in those 3 playoff games, 24, 27, 26. He scored 4 times in those 3 games. That tells you what the Jaguars want to do in their big games. Fournette is as big a part of this game plan as anyone in the offense. We know exactly what the offense is. It's feeding Fournette. Kill the clock and let their defense dominate other teams. They brought in no outside help for the running back spot. They do have TJ Yeldon, who is a good change of pace back. And they have the explosive Corey Grant, of course. So I'm not writing off, but there's no way that Corey Grant is eating into Fournette's workload. I get it. Good things happen when Corey Grant is on the field. It seems like he's breaking away like a 50-yard run every time he's there. But I'm not even considering him a threat to the workload for Fournette because he's not. They're just different players, and I don't know. People get excited about it, but the Jags OC literally came out and said they need to get Grant out there more. But this is what he said, like, quote unquote, "I love to put him out there more because he's a major change of pace back." You know what a change of pace back is? Every team in the NFL has a change of pace back. That's another word for backup, a change of pace. When our starter, when our featured workhorse is tired, we get our change of pace back in there. That's what Corey Grant is. He's not an actual threat to Fournette's workload. But as I was saying, right, Fournette is absolutely not a zero in the passing game either. And I think people expected that out of him. So out of the 16 games Fournette played in last year, he caught multiple passes, so two or more passes in every single one of them, except for one. In 15 of 16 games, he caught two or more passes. So he's consistently involved in every game. If you counted the three playoff games along with the 13 regular season games, 60 targets and 43 catches. That is, like, very good for someone that people consider not a big part of the passing game. And what's funny is I actually looked at the splits. If you look at them here, it was with TJ Yeldon on the field and without TJ Yeldon, who was also very involved in the passing game, seeing 41 targets. So from the running back position, that's a pretty heavy workload. I wanted to see if having Yeldon on the field impacted Fournette's workload in the passing game, and it was actually the opposite. In games, the in-split is games where Yeldon played, and Fournette actually averaged half a reception more and almost a full target more in games where Yeldon played. So again, I repeat to you, guys, the only downside to Leonard Fournette is his injury concern. And that's going to be subjective to you. If you're someone who's like, I want zero risk, I want no injury risk going into 2018, then you could fade Fournette. But I would say if he's healthy throughout training camp, he looks like a beast in preseason, and there are literally not a single report or any mention of his lower body, and they're saying he's explosive and he looks really healthy with the lost weight and he's looking slim and explosive, guys, Fournette is going to be an absolute monster this year, and he's one of my favorite picks in the first round. And I get a lot of questions like, if Fournette drops like 11 or 13, should I grab him and Melvin Gordon? Dude, I love both of them. And that's where we're going to jump into the conclusion here. At the end of the day, I love both of these backs, right? Sometimes I make these videos and I'm like, I don't really want them at their ADP, or, oh, I'm going to fade this guy and I like this guy. But these are two guys that I like both equally, right? And like, you look at Kareem Hunt and Delvin Cook. I said I don't like either of them at their current ADP. I have them ranked 17 and 19. So I don't just say this for all my in the mucks. This pair in particular, I like both of them. I would be happy to have either of them as my RB1 in fantasy this year. And like I said, I get a lot of questions. Like, I get a lot of ones who are like, I'm the 12-13 turn, right? The last pick in the 12, in a 12-man league. Should I get Gordon and then a wide receiver, or Fournette and a wide receiver? I'm like, dude, if you can get both of these guys, Gordon and Fournette, that is a monster stack in the first round. And I absolutely love pairing these guys together. But if I had to choose between the two, it's Fournette for me, if you couldn't already tell how excited I am about it. I have it written here, actually. He is my 7th ranked overall player this year, and I'm debating moving him up above Barkley, but I don't think I'm going to do that just because of after having Dr. Jesse Morse on the show and how he's a little bit concerned with the injury with the ankle. He is my number 7. I have Gordon at number 9, but his sheer volume floor, like I've just been explaining to you guys for the last 30 minutes, is just so high, as is his scoring upside. And I saw on the Vegas odds that Fournette's touchdown, it was like his over-under for touchdowns was 10.5, but it was like minus 160. So he is a heavy, heavy favorite to hit 11 touchdowns this year, if not more, per Vegas. So they're not always right, but they know what they're doing to win money. I love Fournette's the touchdown upside. He scored 9 rushing touchdowns in 13 games and then plus 4 in the playoffs. So 13 in a 16-game span. They add Andrew Norwell to the offensive line, which is already very improved, and you know exactly what they're going to do, man. So with Gordon, like I said, I like him too, but you know, the offensive line is not a good offensive line as of right now. It's a lot of upside there, but there's still concern on whether or not Pouncey can stay healthy, whether or not Forrest Lamp is even going to be ready for the year. It's possible Ekeler eats more into the passing game than we imagine, but I don't really see that happening. But I think Gordon will still get a nice workload. But at the end of the day, man, I think Fournette is guaranteed 20 touches every time he's on the field, and he's a pretty good bet to score a rushing touchdown or at some kind of touchdown every time he's on the field. So that will wrap up this week's In the Muck Monday. Leonard Fournette versus Melvin Gordon. My personal opinion, Leonard Fournette. Let me know who you want down below in the comments. Make sure you leave a thumbs up if you enjoyed the video, got some value from it. Make sure you subscribe to the channel if you're new. We do In the Muck like this every single Monday. I think for the rest of August, this is my content calendar going forward. I'm having videos coming out basically every single day starting on Friday. We don't miss a beat. 7 motherfucking days a week. Who you know putting out seven goddamn videos a week? I'm a one-man show over here doing that. And you know I'm bringing the grit. Let's fucking go. I'm pumped up for August, man. I'm pumped up to grow, to get better. And if you want to join the fam and watch us grow, please subscribe to the channel. And I'll see y'all on Wednesday, which is my wild stats from fantasy football video. Next week will be Michael Thomas versus Julio Jones in the muck. Peace!